Welcome back to the Caucus Room. I'm your chairman, Don Calloway, and today we have a very, very special episode. I know I say that every week, but today is a special episode because we are doing a St. Louis-centric episode to react to recap the epic congressional race between sitting United States Congresswoman Cori and her opponent who defeated her last night, the prosecuting attorney for St. Louis County, Wesley Bell, who is now the Democratic nominee for the first congressional district of Missouri. He will be facing off against a Republican in November. But as we know from not only St. Louis politics, but Democratic politics across the country, last night was the effective race to determine who the next congressperson will be. So for all intents and purposes, Wesley Bell has defeated two-term incumbent Congresswoman Cori, and we are now moving into a Wesley Bell era as St. Louis region's representative here in Washington, D.C. in the United States Congress. I'm very excited that I have three absolute veterans of not only St. Louis, not only Missouri, but national politics. Well, two absolute veterans of St. Louis and national politics to discuss the race. Nobody I could imagine better to break it down with than my dear friends. First is Jason Rosenbaum from St. Louis Public Radio. Young man, but a veteran craftsman of political journalism, worked at the state level, the city level, the county level, knows everybody and everything anyone could ever want to know about St. Louis politics. And I admire him greatly because he's never presented his political analysis with a personal agenda, and has really toiled in the vineyards for a long time to give the people of St. Louis and Missouri, and frankly, America, the truth about what's happening in St. Louis politics. So welcome, Jason. The other is OG Mike Jones. And, you know, his resume is too long to recount here. We only have an hour. But suffice it to say that his shoulder is already full of stripes, so it ain't too many more stripes he could get on his uniform or plaques that could go on his wall. Mike Jones has seen it all, done it all, not only in St. Louis politics, but in national politics and state politics. And I don't know that there's anybody else in the country whose not only opinion I trust more, but who I have learned more about the basic and fundamental workings of St. Louis politics, national politics, and really global politics. So welcome the OG, Mike Jones. I've got you both with me. I do this a lot back and forth with each of you individually, and I'm very excited to get the three of you all together, to get the two of you all together, the three of us together. I've gotten tons of inquiries over the course of the last 6 months about how the race is gonna go. The business community tends to ask me who was gonna win, and the people tend to ask me who to vote for. Those are two dramatically different questions, and I'm looking forward to breaking down all of that retrospectively here with Jason Rosenbaum from St. Louis Public Radio and Mike Jones from General OG-dom. So we're going to go to Jason first to give us his particular brand of breakdown, and then we'll go to the OG to respond with some thoughts. You got the floor, Jason Rosenbaum.
Thank you so much, and it's an honor to be in the caucus room. So for people that don't already know, Wesley Bell has defeated Cori in the race for the first congressional district. I don't have ward-by-ward numbers in the city, but St. Louis County has updated their election system to where you can actually download precinct results, which is pretty great, which means you can put them in an Excel file and then tabulate how people did in a particular township. And what was striking to me, because if you look at for your listeners or watchers who don't know, the first congressional district consists of all the city of St. Louis and a large portion of the St. Louis County, not the St. Louis County, it's not the Ohio State University, it's just St. Louis County, but you get my point. But primarily like the African American portion of St. Louis County. And if I'm not mistaken, and I'm sure Mike we'll point this out, I think the largest concentration of Black voters maybe in North St. Louis County in the entire state. And it is what I would classify as a very economically mixed part of the African American community in St. Louis County. You could go to Pasadena Hills and see Black people living in mansions, and then you could go to Wellston and see not a lot of great stuff. So my takeaway is Cori Bush totally failed to get her margins where she needed to get it in St. Louis County. The fact that she only won two townships, and not by that much, like I think by a combined 700-800 votes, and these were two majority Black townships, means that she lost a bunch of majority Black townships, including places like Spanish Lake Township, I think Lewis and Clark, maybe two. And I don't know about Midland. Is Midland like the one where you used to represent in the House, or am I thinking of like, am I thinking of a different township?
I had a part of Midland Township, but I had a part of most of them that you could mention just because of the Understood. Crazy way the district was drawn.
Understood. So I had said all along, and I talked with you, Don, privately, and I was texting with Mike on the day of the election, that Wesley's challenge was being able to attract like the Black voters that voted for Cori in 2022 when she walloped Steve Roberts by like 70-30%. Because I think if you look at the precinct results in St. Louis County or the ward by ward results in St. Louis City, she won all the African American heavy areas by like 40 percentage points. Well, she didn't do it this time. And I'm pretty sure that we're all going to talk about the fact that like pro-Israel groups got heavily involved, and they spent millions upon millions of dollars on a very aggressive.
Are we going to say pro-Israel groups, or are we going to say AIPAC?
No, I mean, I'm saying pro-Israel groups because it's not just AIPAC. There was also Democratic majority for Israel, which I think is separate from AIPAC. You would know more than I would. But like, that's why I say pro-Israel groups. But yes, the Democrat, I think the United Democracy Project, which is the PAC linked to AIPAC, I think they spent at least $9 million, which for the first congressional district race, I don't think that's like unheard. That's an unheard of amount of money for this district. Like,
it is
insane. It's amount unprecedented. Of money. So my biggest question going into this was that money going to move Black voters? And I think the answer is it did. Like, why else would people who voted for Cori Bush in 2022 not vote for her this time if they weren't influenced by the massive ad campaign by Bell and his allied PACs? And I don't know. I'm sure we're going to get into the nuances and complexities of the Israeli-Palestinian conflict in this discussion. I know it's a very emotionally charged issue, not only for people who live in the first district who are Palestinian or who are from, you know, Arab countries, Arab Muslim countries, and feel very strongly about that subject. Like, I think the Jewish population in St. Louis, it is split between the first congressional district and the second. So I think when people say that it's all concentrated in the first, I don't think that's true. But I do think there's a significant Jewish population. And I think that they were genuinely very angry at the way Cori Bush handled her reaction to the Hamas attack on October 7th. But I said for a while, I think this was going to be one of the most important elections in recent St. Louis history. I stand by that hyperbole. I think it's true. I think there's going to be a lot of ramifications and blowback from this that are going to last more than just this week. And I think it's really going to be up to Wesley Bell to bridge a lot of schisms and divides that have emerged here.
Right on. Thank you for the synopsis, Jason. I was taking some notes, and I want to pick into some of that in just a moment. But I'm going to defer to the OG jazz man himself on tenor sax, Mike Jones.
Thanks, Don. And Jason, it's great being with you guys this afternoon, because we talk independently to each other all the time. And I agree with everything you said about Jason, Don. And I want to put my remarks foundation built on the foundation that Jason just laid out, because I got quoted in Politico as saying that I thought this race would say more about the state of the Black community than it would about Cori Bush and Wesley Bell. And that the real story will be what happens afterwards. And with what Jason just outlined, it kind of made me seem somewhat precious, and I don't claim to be, but the notion that the money moved the voters was what I was looking at, because to Jason's point about the amount of money spent, about $25 million was spent, about 18 on behalf of Wesley Bell, about $6 million Cori Bush, and $25 million hasn't been spent in the first congressional district campaign, probably in the last 20 years collectively. So it's an absurd amount of money. But the question was going to be, given where the money came from, how would Black voters feel about that kind of initiative? And we would say almost an invasion of the district to restate the leadership as a function of a political stance of a congresswoman. It isn't really tied particularly to the district being at least a priority of the district. And I didn't know if that would happen. And Jason just gave the answer to that. Yes, it did. Because the only rational reason that many Black voters in St. Louis County would move from one place to the other in 2 years when not a anything substantive really happened in terms of intervening events, says that the money really did make a difference. And the question that I would put on the table, if that much outside money can move a base voter in a Black congressional district, will that be a message to other well-financed outside interests that they can actually change Black leadership by spending enough money? And I think that's the real discussion for the Bell and Bush race, about what it could mean in terms of Black politics going forward.
Well, I will give you all the same assessment that I gave to the community members pre-election day. And I think now we have the benefit of knowing the outcome, but I think that my thought process of my general thoughts on the race is the same, you know, today as it was 2 weeks ago. I think that Cori Bush was not the best congresswoman for our region. I think that Cori Bush is a remarkable and dynamic activist, and she could have grown into being an amazing legislator, member of Congress. But we've been around the game long enough to understand that a really good activist does not necessarily make a great legislator. I think that there were some things in terms of how the Washington, D.C. game is played that Cori's office simply never chose to participate in. The commerce of the town, the culture of the town, the schmoozing of the town. And for better or for worse, those things are often anathema to the spirit of an activist, but they are essential to the job of being a member of Congress. And that, in addition to some professional mishaps along the way, both substantive, like voting against the Biden infrastructure package, which is one of the signature, if not the signature achievement of his administration, as well as, you know, the basic failure to fundraise while one was there, and the paying her husband security. We know it's not illegal, but it didn't look good, and it was an easy messaging point for attack. I think that her failure to rise to the job of being a legislator eventually made her extraordinarily vulnerable to a credible candidate. So 2 years ago, you know, we all know him, we all like him, but Steve Roberts was not a credible candidate because of some of the challenges that he had. Wesley Bell was an extraordinarily credible candidate who already had an extraordinary amount of name recognition and frankly, credibility amongst core constituencies in the district. He has gotten more votes than any Democrat in the state over the last 10 years, maybe with the exclusion of Jay Nixon. But Wesley Bell was a credible candidate and he found her extraordinarily vulnerable. And if we are being honest, and I want to make sure, don't just clip this and get mad at me. Hear me out. Wesley Bell, I believe, given the case I just made for the job of a legislator, knowing Wesley Bell and not knowing but observing Cori, I think Wesley would do a better job as a legislator, as our congressperson, than Cori Bush did over the past 4 years. Here's the caveat. Unfortunately, my political orientation starts and ends with me being that of a Black man. Double unfortunately, I was trained in the Michael Wesley Jones School of Black Politics, such that when I send someone into the arena as a Black person, and particularly to represent a Black seat and Black interests, and I still believe most CD1 is a Black seat that represents African-American interests, I like to be able to trust that this person will represent our interests. The tremendous amounts of money that Wesley got from not only outside interests, not only pro-Israel interests, but frankly, white money is not a good sign for me. It doesn't sit well in my heart. So if I were still a full-time St. Louis voter, I probably would have voted for Cori Bush because while I think that she had a lot of room for improvement in the job, I think that Wesley Bell can't necessarily be trusted to represent Black interests. And the reason I say that is because there are five or six things which came to light over the course of the last 6 months that in aggregate don't suggest that we know with great confidence that he could be trusted to represent St. Louis community's Black interest when the doors is closed, the cameras is off, and the deals are going down. I like Wesley. I think Wesley is extraordinarily talented, and I think he will do a great job as congressperson. But frankly, I do not love or even like the fact that external white money elevated Wesley and put him in the seat, which is a Black congressional seat. I was taught, and I believe, that we cannot allow white interests to choose Black leadership. And after all of the smears and all of the data points, to me, that's what this feels like. And I will tell you one data point that sticks out to me pretty significantly is the fact that the pro-Israel money, we can call it AIPAC or whatever else, and I think you were right, Jason, in characterizing it as the collective pro-Israel money, they made the same offer to Hill Harper in Michigan. We have to remember that Wesley was first running for Senate against Lucas Kuntz. The pro-Israel money made the same offer to Hill Harper in Detroit to get out of the Senate race, to get in the congressional race and take on Rashida Tlaib. And he declined. Wesley took the deal. And I think as a result, he had an overwhelming amount of money that the organized grassroots activists and political enthusiasts on the ground simply did not have the yardage to overcome. Now, I believe if the race had had another month, as many things as were piling up and with the energy and activism I saw on the ground from brothers like Tef Poe and Gerald Christmas, I think that they could have overcome Wesley's money lead, which simply allowed him to inundate airwaves and mailboxes with pro-Wesley, anti-Cori messaging. I think that if the field had been a little bit longer, if it had been another 10 meters, Cori might have been able to pull it out. But that amount of money is simply overwhelming, and I think it left him as a, in a deficit. Now, I will close with this. I'm in D.C. I work in the Capitol. I am here to make sure that Wesley succeeds and does extraordinarily well because I care about our city and our region of St. Louis. And I think he will have a hard hurdle to overcome in earning the trust of not only the St. Louisans who were skeptical of how he got the job, but also the operatives in Washington, D.C., who are not blind, deaf, or dumb to how he got here as well. But I want Wesley to succeed, and I think he has all the tools to be a wonderful congressperson if he is able to set his hands to the task of immediately beginning to try to bridge the gap.
Couple things, Don. First of all, I think your critique of Cori is accurate and objective. And in talking about her shortcomings over the first 4 years, you noted there was room for improvement. She obviously had some places to get better at, but she had time to get there. And what troubles me is none of those shortcomings should have generated $18 million against the candidate. I have heard no flaw that would generate $18 million of opposition.
That's right.
Okay. So.
Because let's be clear, there's a lot of really inadequate members of Congress, and they don't get that deluge.
And that's my point. So that actually means the race could not have been about her shortcomings because he had the same shortcomings 2 years ago, probably more because he was even younger in the job. And as you say, there are probably a half a house full of Congress that basically are in that same need to improve area, and they don't generate $18 million worth of opposition funding.
That's right.
So the question becomes, it was about something else. I think your critique of Wesley is also spot on. And with it, the challenge that you outlined, trust broken or the perception of trust broken. And so it really doesn't matter what you were trying to do. What matters is how people understood what you were trying to do. And that's like Humpty Dumpty, man. That is hard to put that egg back together. And I don't know how, once that's violated between a leader and the led, that you actually are able to reconcile that and get forgiven. You might get tolerated, but you'll never get forgiven, and you'll lose one of the most important things a leader needs, and that is credibility and the benefit of the doubt. That ultimately, when you're in leadership, you're going to get things wrong because nobody's right. The question is, do people trust you? And if they do, they give you the benefit of the doubt for your mistakes. Not that you're not going to make them, but they don't presume nefarious reasons for your behavior that didn't work. It's a judgment that didn't work, but they still trust your judgment.
They still trust that you're one of us, that you have our best interest. Even, you know, politics is made for general disagreement. Jason, you got any further thoughts here?
Yeah, I think it's really appropriate that you have Bill Clay's book behind you. I have not read that entire book, although I do have an autographed copy of it because I emailed Bill Clay once and he sent me that book, and that was very nice of him to do. I'm a big admirer of Bill Clay. I have said privately, I guess I'll say publicly now, if you created a Mount Rushmore of Missouri political figures from the 20th century, I would put Bill Clay up there with Champ Clark, Harry Truman, Thomas Eagleton, whatever, because he there was always going to be the first Black St. Louis congressman because of what Mike and I have talked about before, about the creation of the first district as a majority or plurality African-American district. But I think it took a real, I'm trying to think of the best word here, an emperor god like Bill Clay to create that seat into a power base for a Black political ecosystem. And I think that's one of the things that he noted in another book that he talked about his rise through St. Louis politics is when he dealt with some largely white constituent organized group, mainly like labor. So let's take the pipe fitters, for example. He was not beholden to the pipe fitters. They were beholden to him. And that's what made the Bill Clay machine so novel, because if you read this book, a lot of the, and I'm sure if I'm wrong on this, Mike can certainly correct me on this. A lot of the early Black political machines in St. Louis were often connected very strongly to a white political machine. And Bill Clay was the first political machine to have white interests subservient to him. So I think I understand your point that there probably is a lot of distrust over, you classify it as white money, you could classify it as like the pro-Israel lobby. We could get into semantics that, you know, there are a lot of Israelis who are not white and they're actually Arab, but let's cast that aside for a minute. I could see why that would be hard for people who are intensely focused on the St. Louis political community to swallow, because they're not used to that. Bill Clay and to some extent Lacey Clay set a standard where if they were going to collaborate with a white interest group, however you want to describe it, it was going to be collaborative kind of on their terms. Look, there are plenty of things you could say about Bill and Lacey Clay as far as their shortcomings. I know that Lacey Clay is not the warmest and cuddliest person in St. Louis politics, but I do think overall his legacy in St. Louis from a political and policy standpoint was a positive one. And certainly his father's were. So I don't know. I guess we'll just have to see whether Bell's stated desire to collaborate and work with everyone actually bears fruit, given that, as you kind of alluded to, this was a very divided electorate. And I think there's a lot of hard feelings after this primary that are not going to go away after a week. I mean, it could be, they may never go away. Just as the funny thing is, I haven't never talked to Lacey Clay about this, but I have talked with people around him. I asked, was Lacey even that upset when he lost? Because now I think he's doing lobbying,
He's an operator out here in D.C.
When
a man runs, you have to imagine he wanted to win. So, let's just get through the, chop through the weeds and get to the idea that he probably wanted to win, which means he probably was disappointed. But as he has since seen in the 4 years subsequent, life certainly goes on and it ain't half bad. So, listen, I'm going to... Mike, I think it's important that Jason brought up some history, because you and I never have a political discussion detached from history. And Jason astutely observed the book in the background. I think it's important to set the context that this seat was one of those first federally created majority-minority districts, and the first occupant of it, William Clay Sr., was a founding member of the Congressional Black Caucus, which is the first time you see Black people intentionally building political power and infrastructure in this country at the federal level. And to me, Wesley's victory is something, it flies in the face of that progress, because it is non-black money determining the victor, determining the holder of a black seat. And let's be clear, there is a little to none possibility of African Americans or even Democrats holding a seat in statewide politics in Missouri. So this is all we have in St. Louis. Obviously, we have Representative Cleaver over in Kansas City, but it doesn't sit right with me. And I like Wesley and I want him to succeed, but it doesn't sit right with me that non-black interests effectively determined the holder of a black seat, which is so important and goes back to the founding of the Congressional Black Caucus, which is frankly why I'm here.
To put Bill in proper context, and I'm saying this as somebody who, when I was a lot younger, didn't always feel this way, but Bill operated not just as a congressional leader, but he was the capo de capi. He was the boss of the bosses politically. And there are two phrases that particularly white politicians of all stripes, as well as a lot of black ones, there are two phrases that dictated you were here in a political conversation in St. Louis about anything important. The first referenced Jordan Chambers. What did Pop say?
Mm-hmm.
The second one was always, in my lifetime, what did Bill say? Have you talked to Bill? Mm-hmm. So we're not talking about just a congressman. We're talking about a physical political presence that defines how St. Louis area politics and by extension Missouri politics could work. Okay. Lacey didn't feel that spot. But
that's right.
That's the essence of that seat. And I would say historically there has always been quote white money involved in black politics. But the white money didn't dictate the terms of the engagement. So they might pick a side in a legitimate black political dispute because they may have had a relationship and an interest in one side or the other. I think what you've alluded to, that this particular race is different, is because the outside money actually created the contest. That without the money, you don't get a credible Wesley Bill. This is not Wesley Bill running, and they decide to weigh in because they got a Cori Bush beef. Because that's kind of in the game, okay? I didn't have nothing to do with it, but if it looks like you're going to be in a fight, I'm going to help the bear, okay? So you can't get mad about it. You can't get mad about that, okay?
Right.
But when somebody from outside creates the opportunity for the opposition inside of the context of the black community, because going to your point that whatever the critique was about Cori, none of it had risen to the level of black dissatisfaction, where people were saying, we need a new, better Congress. Okay? Now, maybe they could have gotten to that point, but they weren't at that point there. So the question only gets called because of the money. So the money...
Because of the money. The money was the enabling factor. Yes. The money was the enabling factor for Wesley's candidacy. And it wasn't his... I think Wesley is brilliant and capable and competent. Those things did not put him on the platform to be able to usurp a two-term congressperson.
Right. And so the angst, the existential angst inside of the black community, the schism, and I think it probably is a schism inside the black community at this moment, is literally about the the circumstances that created this particular situation. And that's what I mean about, that gets to be hard to reconcile. Now, you're in Washington, D.C., and I don't know anything about the internal workings of Congress, but I've been a practicing black politician most of my life. And your generation of politicians have tendency to be more businesslike and concerned with the niceties of this. I'm the end of an era where politics was much more a street game than it was a boardroom game. And if I were a member of the Congressional Black Caucus, with this being the second member of the caucus that's been brought down as a result of AMAC money or pro-Israeli money, I think I got a bone to pick with you. And I got a bone because that's the Avon Barksdale in me that you just can't come in and take no corners from me, okay? And me say that's okay, okay? So now it ain't even about Cori Bush. It ain't even about Bowman. It's about you can't do that here without a penalty.
And you're in bias.
And I would – huh?
You can't just come in here and buy a seat.
No, that's it.
You can't just come in here and buy it.
Well, matter of fact, if I were in the Black Caucus, my message to them would be the last thing you really want to hear from a serious man, it ain't about the money no more. Okay? that fundamentally, you're going to have to answer. You'll have to pay for Santino. I'm sorry, okay? I mean that. Because if I don't make you pay, then every right-wing crackpot in America who's got a checkbook with a dollar more than Carfax can think they can come into my money, into our community and decide who it is. And if movies based on reality, even Lucky Luciani stopped at 110th Street because he said, you got to talk to Bumpy about that. Okay. So if you can stop the biggest gangsters in America, I know you can stop some political operators. And I would make them feel it. I mean, seriously. So to me, it ain't even about Israel. It ain't about none of that no more. It's about, it's 60 of us, and if we let this go, everybody will think they can do that because it ain't no penalty.
So even if, and that's the thing, like, and you don't think that's mitigated at all by the new congressman being an African American?
I don't care about that no more.
Yeah.
That's, you did this two times. The first time, I might even look the other way. The second time, I ain't.
Yeah, yeah.
And well, I could have not liked both of them, and it don't matter now, okay?
I think that's fine. Listen, I know that you know I understand exactly what you mean there. I don't have to have a huge affinity for Cori Bush or Jamal Bowman to not like how they were taken out.
And now I just going to say one thing. You didn't even get permission.
You didn't get permission. I mean, you didn't, because I might have worked with you to do it. I might have worked with you to do it. Yeah, yeah, that's right. Yeah,
but
that's
you didn't, right. But yeah.
You know, I want to. So a friend of mine called me last night, and I'm sure you have friends like this. He's successful and prestigious, but he's always wanted to be in politics, but never ever in life is he gonna take the leap. And so he called me last night and said, man, Wesley Bell is about to live out my dream. And to your point that you just made, I said, nah, man, I don't know, because Wesley Bell is gonna have some tough sledding. At least 50% of his community is skeptical, and with good reason. And I'm saying skeptical at best, right? If you voted for Cori, you necessarily didn't want Wesley, but at best, you are skeptical. At worst, you are deeply angry, offended. Right? A la Gerald Christmas, who we both know and love.
Right.
he says there will be an insurrection in the streets if Wesley Bell is our congressman. And perhaps it won't be that extreme, but I will tell you that in my assessment, Wesley Bell has a very difficult job ahead, because you have to, and I've learned this lesson very, very painfully on my own, you have to have the support, the broad support of Black people as a Black politician. It is essential to your success. So what do you think the road forward looks like for a Congressman Wesley Bell?
I have no idea, okay? you have a better insight on Washington. Back here, the reactions could be from active hostility to just sullen failure to participate. You know, it's like kind of like you hear, but don't nobody care. Okay,
disengagement. And yeah,
disengagement, emotional disengagement. Okay,
and
so you don't know, but to your point earlier, the whole situation has not sit well. Okay,
it does not sit well.
And yeah, and.
At best. And that's the best thing you can say, is that it does not sit well in the hearts of any truly committed Black folk who give a damn about St. Louis. It does not sit well. And I'm not going to say only Black folk, because I've had good, well-meaning white folks like, hey, man, what should I do here? Cori Bush has a lot of shortcomings, but I find her to be a good person. I don't like Wesley buying this seat. And what should I, that question to me has come from thoughtful, not even progressive, but thoughtful, staunch Democratic white folks. It doesn't sit well.
And it goes to what I would think is a critical point, that if you were in Wesley's situation, you needed to answer. And you have reminded me that I said this. You remind me on a regular basis, you've got to define the Black benefit. Before you do something as a Black leader, you have to be able to explain to Black people why this is in their interest. And if you can't, you ought not do it. Even if it's an okay thing. If you can't say to Black people, here is how we benefit. Here's how you benefit. And if they have come to trust your judgment,
yes,
even if they don't quite understand it, I'll trust you because I have been able to trust you. When you can't define the benefit, and we don't have a track record. Because to be honest, you said it in your opening, to be a Black political leader. And for me, I'm like you. Black is not an adjective, it's a noun, okay? And so that means Black political leader is just a compound noun, okay? But Black is not an adjective in this. It is the key factor. The problem, or the concern, I won't say it's a problem, it could be a problem for him, but when you don't understand that as an existential question, it really puts you in a bad place with Black people, because that's usually the question that you would have to answer yourself before you ever did this, before anybody knew you were going to do it.
That's right.
Sitting in your room alone.
Spoiler alert. Spoiler alert. In the search for a benefit to Black folks in any political move, your personal ambition is not the answer. That's not a benefit to Black folks, right? Your personal elevation is not a benefit to Black folks. But there's an important corollary. Number one, any African-American politician, any Black politician should be able to define a Black benefit before taking a potential position on anything of consequence. The second part of that is...
is White folks don't get to define the Black benefit.
Hallelujah. Say it again. Say it again.
White folks don't get to define the Black benefit.
And again, I like Wesley. I've worked with Wesley. I think he's a good and decent person. But at the core, what doesn't feel good about this is that it feels like through the money and through the advocacy, this is white folks defining who should have a historically Black and historically important congressional seat. This is white folks defining the Black benefit for us in a way that simply doesn't feel comfortable.
And to that point, Don, one of the first things that I learned about communication is people are always right about the way they feel. You may say, I wish you didn't feel that way, but if that's the way you feel, that's real. Nobody can tell you you don't feel that way. And whatever makes you feel that way, you're expressing, you are the author of your feeling, okay? So somebody has to meet you where you are. When you say, this doesn't sit well with me, I don't feel good about this.
Yeah,
that's not an argument. I made a declarative statement of reality. This is the way I feel.
Yeah.
Now, you can take exception to it, but it won't change how I feel.
Jason has rejoined us, and Jason, I want to pull you back in, but I got one more question for you, Mike, that you're probably best situated to answer. Over the course of the campaign, I began to see one of Congresswoman Bush's, I would say, weaknesses being exploited, and it caused a divide in the Black community, which I would say, through no fault of her own, this is just who she is. Cori Bush, as an activist, does not look and sound like the Black respectability that we want our Black politicians to look and sound like. Historically, we will give a state rep seat, maybe a state senate seat, a city council or a county council seat to the Black activist. But for a congressional seat, which is the most prestigious thing we have in the Black body politic in a region in most cities, Cori Bush does not conform to the notion of what an older generation of African-American electorate who are bought into this notion of Black respectability, she don't look or sound like that, right? And it felt to me like Wesley did look and sound like that. Steve Roberts did look and sound like that. So she would have ultimately always been somewhat vulnerable to a Black dude with no facial hair and could tie a strong Windsor knot and speak the King's English. Am I misreading that? I don't think I am, but I want your thoughts on that quick.
I would say there were two Black pots here, and the anti-Bush pot was primarily based on style. I mean, because if you take the merit of the issues and the inability to explain the rationale for the Biden thing is more political malfeasance than inexperience. Because I understood it what it was. It was a play, and without the speaker releasing them, they never would have voted against it anyway. But if they needed to be there, they would have been there. So everybody's making a statement because you can afford it, but you got to come home the day you do that to explain it. You can't wait
explain,
a year and a
yes.
half late. You can't wait a year and a half later trying to explain it. So that, but that's the inexperience and the learning that you were talking about. So I think her black negativity rating was all about style points, the respectability thing. I think Wesley was unfairly judged as prosecuting attorney, because in my position, when I looked at it, I thought he politically handled the job well and made a lot of right calls. And you got all of the judgment calls. I mean, if this was baseball and you were the pitcher, he called all the corner. He gave you the corner, okay? So you picked up all of those strikes. But for folks who are activists in criminal justice, you know, they need purity. So you go always, as a politician who's got to operate in the real world, you're going to always have problems from that sense. So those are the two negativity things that were just inherent in both candidates that did not rise to being definitive or determinative factors in any race, okay? But so then you go back to the money again. That the only reason we're having this conversation is where the money came from. And the money was determinative. Matter of fact, the money was always seeking a candidate. The money was in St. Louis wow. last summer looking for a candidate, okay? They were shopping. You know, they had the matter of fact, and they would talk to anybody black breathing. And they were prepared, to go as large as they had. So this was, you know, this was problematic. And for me, it just really came down to were we as a black community politically sophisticated enough to see past our prejudices and short-term issues to understand what the bigger play was. And the answer is obviously not, because if we had, they could have spent twice as much money and it wouldn't have made any difference. And just from an old school standpoint, because in your era, this era, we don't spend money like that. But you couldn't have spent, back in Bill Clay's day, you couldn't have spent $8 million on television. You'd have had to pass some of that money around.
Go have a right. Right.
Somebody
right.
said, man, there's no way in hell you can say we're going to spend $20 million on TV. She said, no, you ain't. I mean, if you're going to spend $20 million, you're going to spend a lot of it in these wards,
that's
in
right.
these townships, okay?
That's right.
Or else we don't have nothing to talk about. So that's something that your generation should reconsider. That there's always been money in politics. It just didn't always get stuck at the top as it does now. So,
right. And that's
but anyway, that's another story for another day.
Jason, I want to pull you back in here. While you were gone, Mike and I just discussed that Wesley inherits a divided constituency at best. Specifically, a divided African-American constituency in which he won, but he certainly was not given a mandate. And there are some people with some deeply and reasonably held skepticisms about who he is and what he brings to the seat. Do you see Wesley, future Congressman Bell, being politically vulnerable in the future? Particularly in those next 1 to 2 terms cycles in which any freshman, sophomore member of Congress is vulnerable?
That is something I was thinking about yesterday. I mean, it really depends on how the next 2 years go for him. There's a lot of things that could occur in a 2-year span that you don't really expect, even in the realm of current events, that kind of make you unpopular. I mean, this calamity in Gaza is clearly one of those things. I mean, we could make a solid argument that had October 7th never happened, maybe Joe Biden is still the presidential nominee. That's kind of a whole story for another day, because, you know, the dude was super old, so he might have left anyways. I don't know. Like, here's something that was notable to me. I often look at, like, especially in St. Louis area races, like, who is with who? That's like a big thing that people look at. And I don't think that, like, elected officials endorsing somebody who's running for Congress or state senate or statewide office is the be-all, end-all. But it is interesting to see how other electeds view somebody. And what was noticeable to me was this was probably the best chance to get rid of Cori Bush. Like, I don't think – had Cori Bush won, I really have a strong – I really have doubts, like – AIPAC or DMFI or any group that opposed her this time would have wanted to dump $20 million for somebody else 2 years from now. So right. For people that I know are not fans of Cori Bush, and I'll just name them, Brian Williams, Carla May. I don't think that, like, Kevin Windham dislikes Cori Bush, but I know he ran against her dad and won. So I don't think they're best friends. All these people have some connections to Lacey Clay. Like, Carla and Brian have extensive Lacey Clay connections. They did nothing to help Wesley. Nothing. They sat on their hands.
Interesting.
Now, part of that could have been because Wesley got into the Senate race when Carla was thinking of running, and Carla was very angry at him. And I still think she's mad at him for that. Brian was obviously thinking of running for Mo-1-2, and Wesley kind of outflanked him. And now he's kind of looking in another direction. I think this is one of those examples of, you know, that not maybe this that wasn't the opportunity for him, but there could be one in the near future. We'll just have to see.
I think
that was noticeable because, like, if they really wanted to oust Cori, they would have helped her. But I think that showcases that they have some unease with Wesley Bell. Like, and are some of it maybe like they may want to run for the seat themselves one day, but, like, I think it's deeper than that. Like, they would have helped him more had they not had misgivings about him. And like, yes. I have a good relationship with Cori, Wesley, even Maria Chappelle Nadal, who was in this race, I have a pretty good relationship with too. But, like, I understand that these people are not universally well-liked, but I think it was interesting that, like, electeds in the Black political community who don't particularly revolve around Cori were not really helping Wesley that much. So, you know, now you can chime in.
I think that's a fascinating point. And it's one that I would not have brought up otherwise, is that you kind of have to look at the entire universe of alignment. And I think, to your point, there is this notion that if you're a young, capable, articulate politician in this town, you certainly don't want to create someone who is going to block you from that position for the next 20 years. But I think you're right that it points to a larger potential unreadiness. And it doesn't even have to say, I don't like Wesley Bell or we're not aligned with Wesley Bell. I do think it is a reasonable move for a Black politician to not align themselves with the way he got there. And right. Not only is it reasonable, but I think it's smart, you know, if Congresswoman Cori Bush was vulnerable, Wesley Bell is not the only person who could have taken the shot. And ergo, Wesley Bell is not the only person who organized pro-Israel money could have found. Like Mike said a moment ago, they were looking for anybody breathing.
Let me interject.
And so you kind of have to ask, why didn't, no, it's cool. You kind of have to ask, why didn't others take that shot? right?
Yeah. And let me just interject for a second. I brought up Carla May. I bring her up all the time. She's my state senator. Mm-hmm. She's in the same labor union as I am. We're both CWA people. I have a lot of respect for her. I understood that, like, she was not going to beat Lucas Kuntz. She has issues mm-hmm. raising money, but I think she's a very talented political leader. But she's also, mm-hmm. like, she came on my show, and her views on Israel are no different from Wesley's, okay? I would argue she's more pro-Israel than Wesley. But she didn't get AIPAC money against Lucas Kuntz, who came on my show and said, I think there should be a ceasefire because I think what's going on now is between two sides right. that, like, don't want to make peace, and it's a real cluster. I think that's an interesting question why, like, AIPAC didn't provide Carla with $10 million to run against Lucas. And, you know, they, I'm not going to like disclose private conversations I've had with her, but, like, yeah, she could have easily been the person that took, you know, decided to run against Cori, and she didn't. She decided to stick with the Senate race that I know, I think deep down inside, she knew she wasn't going to win. But I think by taking the path she did, she still, I think, has, like, options in the future, especially when it comes to citywide sure. politics, where she doesn't, where she's, people aren't going to be like, oh, you did this, or you took this interest group's money and you sold out your principles. I'm not saying that's what Wesley Bell did. You all can make that determination yourself, but I could see that being an issue for her. If, say, she ran against Cori Bush and she lost, but then she wanted to run for, like, St. Louis Board of Aldermen president or mayor or something like that. So that,
I think the more appropriate comparison, despite the fact that Carla and the congressional district are both in St. Louis, I think the more appropriate comparison is Hill Harper, who in fact did not get out of the Senate race in Michigan, and presumably got verbatim the same offer letter that Wesley ended up accepting. Because the reality is, Hill Harper lost last night, and he was not going to win in a Democratic primary, just like Carla May was not going to win in a Democratic primary. And that's part of the thought process, is that, hey, you and I both know you're not going to win, so let me fund you to attack this other African-American in a race that you can indeed win.
Yeah. With these resources. I think Carla would have beaten Cori. I think she would have. If she had $10 million at her disposal, like, yeah, she has some vulnerabilities like every other politician, but I would argue less. I think she would have beaten Cori. I think she would have, yeah. But she decided not to do that. And now, you know, maybe she did that because it just felt right to her, and she can go on her last 2 years in the Senate feeling good about herself.
Jason raised a point that I think is the core of the matter. Carla has a position on Israel, her personal position is totally consistent with theirs. I think she probably didn't run because where the money comes from doesn't feel right, to Don's earlier point. But I think the other part of the money is AMAC trying to send a message to Black congressional elected that don't step outside of this line or else we will defeat you. And that's another, see, to me, I think you got to be more Avon Barksdale than Stringer Bell if you go be a successful politician. You got to have some dog in you. And at some point, you're going to have to say message received and your reply is in the mail, okay? So I heard you. But I got something to say about that too. So whoever, we're not going to be the only one damaged in this fight. Now, the question is, right. How much of your ass do you want to risk? And that was one of the first lessons I got in politics from St. Washington. Before I ever got elected, he told me, Michael, if you go do this, understand one thing. To get some ass, you got to bring some ass. And you don't let nobody leave their ass at home, okay? So at that point, I'm coming with everything. And if you ain't coming with everything, you know what? I think you just got pumped. But I'm here for the fight. And I think this more entrepreneurial bourgeois black politics that you got now makes people reluctant to think that at some level, this is really a gangster's hustler's game. And if you too Ivy League, you really ain't going. I think Kamala Harris is going to rout Donald Trump because she got enough dog in her, okay? He is looking to not only beat him up, to humiliate him, embarrass him, and run him out of town. And that's how you got to bring it. If you're not built like that, you will never be any good at this. You really won't. You'll always be soft. You'll always be too weak. And you'll never get done what you ought to get done. He's going to be the next president of the United States because he's tougher than him. And he's nastier about being tougher than him. Her job is she's doing it every day. To humiliate him. And here's the thing. She can keep it up for 90 days. She might not have kept it up for a year.
She can do it for 90 days.
So that's how long president. Oh, 90 days. Matter of fact, 90 days, she's going to be Arkansas, Nolan Richardson's Arkansas Razorback. She's going to be 40 minutes ahead, 94 feet for 40 minutes. We're not letting up. Trump's fat, lazy ass cannot handle that. And that's why she's going to be president of the United States.
As we wind down.
Go ahead. Nothing to do with strategy.
Yeah, yeah. As we wind down, I would love to know what the future looks like for the district. So what does the future look like the next 5 to 10 years for a congresswoman, soon Congresswoman Emeritus Cori Bush? And what does the future look like for a presumptive Congressman Wesley Bell, who is going to have to represent this entire district and hopefully build some consensus in order to succeed at his job?
I'll try to field that first. And is that okay? And then I'll let Mike have the last word on this. I think it's going to be very similar to the 2010s. I think one of the reasons why I alluded to that maybe Lacey wasn't that upset not to be in Congress anymore, because if you go back to the 2010s, he had a battle every cycle. Now, yes, 2014, he didn't have a real opponent, but he was in a proxy war with Maria Chappelle Nadal in a very ugly state rep race featuring Josh Peters and Chris Carter Sr., which I covered extensively because I knew what was going on there. And then he had Maria in 16, and then Cori Bush 1, and then Cori Bush 2. I think that it's going to be a very similar thing going forward, where whoever has this seat, every cycle is going to be competitive. You're going to have a real opponent spending real money against you. You're not going to be like, you know, your former colleague, Jason Smith, who has like two whatever opponents every cycle, and he just coasts to victory. I think this is the new normal in the first district. But if you think about it, it's been the new normal since Russ Carnahan decided to run against Lacey Clay in 2012. And it really hasn't stopped since then. Now, I don't live, by the way, the funny thing about this conversation, I don't even live in the first congressional district anymore, because my house in Richmond Heights got put into Ann Wagner's district. And I guarantee you that was not an accident, because that part of Hadley Township was Cori Bush Central in 2020. And I think that that was very purposely done to by the legislators who did it to weaken Cori Bush long term. But here's the thing, and I unless I read the numbers wrong, she got crushed in Hadley Township yesterday. And that is like, I don't want to say it's as white as like Jefferson Township, which is like Webster Groves. It's whiter than it probably was 10, 20 years ago. It's where the Maplewood Richmond Heights School District is, which used to be half and half between white and black. And now I think it's 70-30 white, because bougie white people like me have moved in there and, you know, made the district white. Oh. So, but my point is, like, I think this is going to be the new normal. Like, I think regardless of who wins in 2026, there's just going to be this constant back and forth between different factions. But yeah.
What's the future for a Congresswoman Emeritus Cori Bush and a future Congressman Wesley Bell?
I really don't know. I'm at 75. I don't make 10-year predictions anymore. But and I don't buy green bananas. Okay, so I want to eat the bananas right away. In 10 years from now, I'm gonna let you guys worry about that. But I don't know. I think Jason has correctly described the county as part of the district. I think it's there's no political cohesion. There's no synergy there to direct it one way or the other. So I think anything is possible. And I don't think you can predict for anybody how this will turn out. I think maybe you can come back in 2 years from now and have this conversation after the next Democratic primary, and you'll have some data or at least some perspective on data and what the last 2 years has been like. And I think you're just going to have to be patient and watch, because this is a seismic event. And like with any earthquake, there's going to be aftershocks. So what we experienced last night was just the initial earthquake. And then the question is, what are the seismic shocks that come after that? And when do they settle down so you can actually then ascertain what damage the earthquake did? But I think we're doing what you're supposed to do in media. We're responding immediately to stuff we don't know.
So I will give a closing question, and I want you guys to close us out however you see fit and get whatever you want to get in. But I do have a centering question. Wesley Bell defeats Cori Bush. Is that the right outcome for the city of St. Louis, Jason?
Ooh, that's a tough question. Because wasn't Cori from St. Louis County too? Weren't these two county people?
I'm sorry. Let me say, is that the right outcome for the first congressional district? How about that?
Thank you. Because technically Lacey absconded to the county too, even though he was a longtime city person. I don't know. I really don't know. And I think time will tell. Like I know people who were very, very opposed to Wesley and were very, very for Cori. And I also know people who I respect quite a bit who were very much vouching for Wesley's character and his ability to deliver. So I think it's going to really be up to him to bridge those two competing thoughts processes together, which I think is going to be extraordinarily difficult. I mean, I know that like through the course of this conversation, we've just brought up like recent examples, but like, let's go back to 2017 in St. Louis City. Lyda Crewson beats Tashara Jones by what, 887 votes? Do you really think those two sides got together in the 4 years afterwards? Absolutely not. They were still wide apart. They did not. So yes, Wesley won by more than 887 votes. Yes, he did. I would push back against anybody who said that this was only like white voters who ushered him into office. That's just not factually true based off the data. While I was gone, was looking at the ward by wards, which came by like to compare by comparison in 2022. If you go by just the African-American wards, Cori was getting between 75 and 80% in those wards. Wesley dropped her down below 60 in each of the heavily African-American wards. So yes, anybody who says this was just a white voter backlash, certainly that was part of it, but it's not the whole story. But like, I think it's very evident that
it's funny. Yeah. Go ahead. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Yeah. I just think that like, based up what we've talked about, I do think that, and not just the Black political community in St. Louis, I'm talking about Black voters in St. Louis, clearly are divided between these two different styles of leadership. And I think it's really incumbent upon Wesley when he's sworn in, if he really is serious about bridging divides and collaborating, he is going to need to do the work to earn the trust of the people that didn't vote for him. And if he can't, then he will be vulnerable just like Cori Bush was.
Mike Jones, was Wesley Bell defeating Congresswoman Cori Bush the right outcome for the people of the 1st Congressional District of Missouri?
Oh, I don't make those kind of ethical, moral, and political judgments. It was the outcome under the circumstances. Okay, so you live with the results, and that's the results. I want to say that I fundamentally agree with Jason. This was, you wouldn't see it without looking at the data that it was white backlash, but it's clear that my earlier comment was true. It says more about where the black community is or isn't than it says any about Wesley or Cori. Okay, so this is fundamentally about a black community in political flux as much as any that outside money took advantage of, but it's clear that there's also something going on within the black community.
I don't know what to say from there, man. But this has been wonderful. I will give you all closing insights from here. You all can close us out in whatever way you see fit. Jason, and then Mike Jones to close us.
Even though I don't live in the 1st Congressional District anymore, I care about it a lot. My family has lived in the 1st Congressional District in one form or another for almost a century. I often bring up the fact all the time that my great-grandparents emigrated from Ukraine, Argentina, Iowa, North St. Louis on the corner of Sarah and Finney is where they had their grocery store. And I believe, based off what my dad told me, that was a black neighborhood when they were there. I could be wrong on that, but I care about the 1st District. I'm not a person that just writes about it because it's an intriguing political battle that never ends. I sincerely want this district to succeed. And I also feel pretty strongly, and maybe I'm influenced by Bill Clay's writing, that I think it is genuinely good for St. Louis to have a black center of gravity, of political gravity, so they can have real tangible power to chart their own destiny. And I think the 1st District congressperson sort of sets that tone. I think we're in a real crossroads here for this district, where there is a real tangible divide about what people want from this member of Congress. And I think Wesley Bell won a very impressive victory based off of, you know, everything we've talked about, but winning an election is just the first tiniest step. And his journey is to actually achieving what he wants, which I'm taking what he says at face value, and that's to make the 1st District better by collaborating with a lot of people that can make it better. That's going to require him to make inroads with the people that didn't vote for him. And we'll see over the next couple of years whether that happens.
Thanks, Jason, man. Really appreciate you. Tell the people where they can find you and where they can follow your work and all of your fantastic insights on not only St. Louis City politics, but Missouri politics and the national spectrum as well.
You can find me at stlpr.org. That's St. Louis Public Radio's website. You can subscribe to Politically Speaking on iTunes, which is the longest episodic podcast about Missouri politics. I'm going to have you on, Don. I feel horrible that I have never asked you formally to be on the show, and Mike has been on four times. So I feel like you're next on the list for that. But I feel like maybe you have outgrown a St. Louis Public Radio podcast at this point. You can also follow me on Instagram, where I do a lot of fun videos about St. Louis and Missouri politics.
Awesome. Thanks so much for being with us. OG Mike Jones, the Dean of St. Louis, if not national black politics. Close us out with some final thoughts here, man.
No, first of all, it's been a gas talking politics with two of my favorite people who are also two of the most informed folks I know about politics. And it's been a real pleasure. So hopefully we've contributed something. I think for me, we are a community in flux, okay? From and I think I think the Americans editorial, endorsement editorial, kind of said it. We are seeing the coming of age of a new political generation of black leadership. And their lived experience is fundamentally different. I didn't say mine and Bill Clay's lived experience. And I don't mean that negatively. I'm just saying time goes on, things evolve. And it's hard to predict what that will look like, because that's what you could kind of guess what I would be based on what Bill Clay was. Okay, because I mean, historically, we're in the same era, more or less. I'm further down the line, but it's the same black experience. Don, you and Jason have a different black experience. What it means to be white in America is different for Jason than what it meant for his father and grandfather. What it means for you to be black in America is different than what it meant for me and your father to be black. And we don't know how that's going to play out over time. But you all, though, are taking the baton, and whatever it is or isn't really will be a function of what you make it. So the question that I would have, a more philosophical one, is, if you coming from my era, the AMAC money and the changing of the congressional seat feels offensive. The question is, in the America in which Kamala Harris could be president of the United States, is that still offensive? Or have we evolved past that more narrow paradigm that I come out of? And is this some kind of new era, new circumstance? And I don't know the answer to that. And I don't think you know the answer to it yet. You might, when you get my age, you might have you might be able to answer the question, because it might take that long for the answer to evolve. But we try to find concrete answers too soon, as opposed to being willing to take a little time and see how the situation evolves, and then make some judgments when we know more, have more experience, greater insight. So I literally don't know what this could be. It could be a disaster, or it could be the best thing that ever happened. But people can tell you how they feel about it now. That's about all.
I know I said the last question was the last word, but what you just said wants me to ask this. How should a black St. Louis body politic who is concerned with the interests of black folks and the most vulnerable folks in the district, how should they feel about a presumptive Congressman Wesley Bell, who got there through means that you just described, and I tend to agree with, as offensive?
Okay, I'll put on what my professional politician had. And one of the things you train yourself in this business is that you don't have personal feelings. You know, you're not permitted for that to influence your decision. So at the end of the day, the requirement of leadership is, what's the best decision? Not the decision I like, but what what should you do that's in the best long-term interest of the people or the community that you have responsibility for leading? Okay, that you asked to lead or they drafted you to lead. So they get that, they are kind of like the fans in the football game. They get to have emotions of response to what play I call or what's going on. But if you're the head coach, if you're the players, you got to figure out what play to run that's going to make a difference at this point in the game. And I don't know. And one would tell me, my experience would tell me is that if I, even though I might not like how I got here, here's where I am. And what matters is what happens next. But I think that's going to be a two-way conversation. The community will have to have that much maturity. And Wesley will also have to understand how he got here and why they feel that way. And everybody's going to have to find a way to get past that, to get to anything productive. Or you can stay mad at each other for the next 10 years and want nothing to get done. So, I mean, the real question is, do we have any adults in the room? You know, and and when you do, you acknowledge that was screwed up. I ain't gonna never forgive you for it, but that ain't why we're here today. Okay, we're here today to conduct the business. So, you know, as the man said at the meeting, but I got another son to bring home from Sicily. That's why I'm here today. Okay, not for the one I lost, but for the one I don't want to lose. So I mean, that you got to be real grown to get there. But I think that's what you ought to strive for. And I don't know what that looks like, and I don't know when that will happen. I don't expect it to happen immediately. So you're going to have to let this kind of run its course till the fever breaks. And then at some point you can have a less emotional conversation about what do we do from And I guess if I had any advice for Wesley, it would be AMAC ain't gonna give you another $18 million. So you're gonna have to find a way to hang on to the seat at a lot much lower price point.
And
try reconciling yourself in some form or fashion to the half of the district that had serious opposition to you. Because reality, $18 million for 51% don't seem like a good bargain.
That is per se evidence of the notion that at some point, I would suggest it's probably around $10 million, there was diminishing returns. You know, to your point, I don't know that Wesley will be as vulnerable as Congresswoman Bush was. Because there will always be the guy, and it'll probably be an ego-driven dude, there will always be the guy who's willing to present with the requisite Black respectability and pull together the activist community and, frankly, the Cori Bush voter who felt wronged, justifiably so. There will always be the opponent coming out of a credible political base in St. Louis. But what Wesley will be able to do that Congresswoman Bush was unwilling to do is make that call in Washington, D.C. Hey, Joe, I know you represent X corporation. We're cool. We have drinks every night. Max me out. And that max out is a $5,000 check. And Wesley will be able to make that call 100 times on day one and build a war chest, which will inherently ward off credible opponents. And the reality is that I don't know that he needs another $18 million from AIPAC, because if he plays the game of Washington, D.C., he will be able to organically build the war chest that comes along with any rank and file member of Congress. And to my opening point, that's something that Cori Bush was simply not interested in doing. And we saw that throughout the 4 years, reflected in her fundraising, quarterly filings. We saw it reflected in the professionalism of her office. Because let's be clear, raising money for your reelect is part of your job, right? Wesley will be able to do that, which will potentially ward off credible opponents. Or if not ward off, it will at least make the opponent's job that much harder, where they will not have as much of a realistic shot as Wesley had. And so
I would, to be honest, I don't see, for somebody who plays the inside game, that as you just pointed it out, I don't see enough money available to an opponent to be credible. Okay, now I can say you could get a credible opponent, but I don't think they have a credible campaign, because I don't think that the opposition money is there. I mean, it just, nobody's going to give you $4 or $5 million to beat an incumbent congressman in the first congressional district. I don't think
who hasn't done something egregious, right?
Right. And that's what we're talking about. We're assuming that that people might have a beef, but they don't have a $6 million hate going on. And I see that. So that means the reconciliation becomes more urgent, because the community's not going anywhere, and he's probably not going anywhere.
And he's not going anywhere. That's right. It's his seat as long as he wants it.
Yeah, so if you put those two things together, at some point, you got to figure out how to make it work, because part of his effectiveness, any politician's effectiveness, is can you legitimately speak for your people? I'm not a preacher, but every now and then I like to tell stories like a preacher. And I think it's Acts 15, where the son, you got five sons of somebody who's, they jealous of Paul because he's doing all this stuff. And they decide that they go drive a demon, a man who's possessed of a demon, they go drive the demon out. So they go to the house and they recognize, and they walk in and they say, tell the demon to be gone. And the demon takes over the guy and he says, hey, man, I know Jesus and I know Paul, but who are y'all? And then he proceeds to whip their ass and run them out the house naked. And I use that as an analogy, is that who you speak for is where your authority comes from. What made Bill Clay powerful wasn't that he was the congressman, but he could speak for the first congressional district. And what he said mattered, because it was the 500 or 700,000 people, however many people were in the district at that time, literally was behind him. So they're not looking at Bill Clay, they're looking at what Bill Clay represents. So for to be an effective political leader, you need to understand it ain't the office that makes you who you are, it's the people that sent you that makes you who you are. And if you got them, you can be the man or the woman. If you don't have them, you're just a brother with a job. So don't get it twisted.
And on that note, that suggests that there is still a highly significant, if not superior, role for Cori Bush's future in Missouri politics, Black politics, and Black activism and advocacy?
Well, I can't speak to the advocacy part, but you're going to have to decide that another from the same gentleman, when I I was a lot younger, and before I was on the board of aldermen, basically Ching told me one day, because he knew my college activism stuff, and he said it like this: you're going to have to decide whether you want to be a politician or a civil rights leader, because you can't be both at the same time. I picked, I wanted to be a politician. Now, I let my activism inform my politics, okay? And it was the context that I kept in mind, but I understood that I wasn't running the outside game, I was running the inside game, and my job was different than that job. So you don't get a chance to bring that into this. Okay, so you got to decide. You want, you know, if you are an activist, you can say I want it all. I want the purity of the deal. I want the purity. When you do politics, politics is ultimately the art of the possible, and you never let the perfect become the enemy of the good. You know, as yes, kind of Clay said, you take what you can, you give up what you must. But trust me, you're always giving up something, because everything with a bill. There's nobody. Matter of fact, if you could take it all, you shouldn't. Because all you're going to do is people mad, and they're going to remember that the last time. So so it's a different skill set. It's a different temperament. And both of them are like art, but they're different. So you and our problem as a community, we don't understand the nuanced differences. You know, real experienced activists, what I call serious people, understand that they got a role, and the politician on the inside has a role. What you look for is the integrity in people to stay connected to the same larger vision. And so that I can trust you and you can trust me, even though it looks like we're doing different things. But we both are on the same page, but it takes both of us to pull this off. You know, as Lyndon Johnson in Selma, when he and Dr. King are on the phone, and I think they're talking about the civil rights bill, and he's kind of stuck, and he tells Dr. King, make me do it, okay? create a situation that forces my hand with the people whose hand I have to force. So I need it. And I would say your generation of politicians are way too sensitive and soft. So they don't understand that part of the job is kicked in the ass so you can go kick somebody else in the ass. And that's all. It's all hustle. And if you ain't got no hustle in you, this is probably bad business for you.
OG, you always lay it down, man, and I deeply appreciate your time. I think that it's fair to say that a keenly interested electorate is waiting to see what the presumptive Congressman Wesley Bell is going to deliver. And I honor Cori Bush, Congresswoman Cori Bush, for her 4 years of not only community activism, but service in Congress. She certainly has push the ball forward in her own way. And for the better of the district, I hope you are right that everyone can lay aside emotions and find a way to be adults, because we're sending Wesley Bell to Washington, D.C. for better or for worse. And St. Louis City has an opportunity where we will likely be in the majority in Congress next year. You will likely have an African-American woman as president next year. And we don't want to miss out on the opportunity that that presents, because we couldn't get over the divisions. Understand they are deep and painful and incredible divisions, but we have to move past them in order to make sure that St. Louis gets its fair share of the pie from whatever is happening in 2025 and beyond in Washington, D.C. OG Mike Jones, man, I deeply appreciate you, my brother. I can't thank you enough, man.
Just one thing, Dan, on that emotion thing. You're going to have to let the motions run their course. And, you know, people say, and this too shall pass. But it can't pass you till it catches you. So, I mean, we're gonna have to go through this to get to where you're talking about going. So,
yeah,
you gotta live with that part of it too.
Yes, indeed. This is the Caucus Room. Appreciate y'all tuning in. Talk soon.